Okay. Good morning and welcome everyone to the 11th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting in hybrid format this week with some of us in the room and others attending remotely. We have apologies from the convener, Dean Lockhart, and from Mark Ruskell. I'm chairing this meeting in Dean Lockhart's absence. Brian Whittle joins us today as a substitute for Dean Lockhart. Brian, welcome. This is the first time you have attended the committee as a substitute, and I therefore invite you to state whether you have any relevant interest to declare.
Thank you, Convener. No relevant interest to declare.
Thank you, Brian. Graeme Simpson will join us later. For clarity, I should state that Graeme will be attending as a non-committee member, meaning he's entitled to attend the public part of the meeting today and to participate in questioning witnesses at my discretion. Agenda item one. At item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Items 4 and 5 is consideration of evidence heard at our two sessions today. Item 6 is consideration of draft letters on carbon capture, utilisation and storage. And finally, item 7 is consideration of the committee's work programme. Do we agree to take these in private? Agreed. That is agreed. Items 4, 5, 6 and 7 will be taken in private. We'll now move on to agenda item 2. And our next item is an evidence session in relation to our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a net zero Scotland. And I refer members to the Clarks and Spice papers for this item. We launched this inquiry in December to look into progress at local level in reaching net zero targets. This inquiry is also considering what role the Scottish Government and its agencies can play in supporting and challenging local government to work well with its partners, and how local government can play its part in ensuring a just transition to net zero. We are now at phase two of our inquiry, looking in depth at key themes to have emerged from our initial evidence sessions and our call for written views. Today we are continuing on a theme of vocational skills and workforce readiness for net zero targets that we began last week. So I'm pleased to welcome our panellists who are joining us remotely. Ian Hill, Industry Insight Manager, and Ian Hughes, Engagement Director Scotland from the Construction Industry Training Board. Gordon Nelson, Scotland Director, Federation of Master Builders. Martin Rain, Technical and Skills Manager, Scottish and Northern Ireland Plumbing Employers Federation. And Grant Tierney, Chair, Local Authority Building Standards Scotland. So thank you for accepting our invitation. We're delighted to have you here. We've allocated around 75 minutes for this panel. So we welcome comprehensive answers, but with five panellists, you'll appreciate we also welcome concise answers where possible. Members will ask questions in turn, and I remind them to direct the question to a specific person on the panel or to set out a running order for answering the questions relevant. So I will begin, and thereafter I will go to Natalie Dawn for the first question from our members. I'd like to ask the first question in relation to looking at industry more broadly and areas in the workforce where witnesses expect current skills gaps to increase or new skills gaps to emerge in relation to the transition to net zero. And perhaps I could come to Ian Hill first, followed by Gordon Nelson. Can I come to Ian, please?
Hi. I think in terms of net zero and the move towards that, I think it's quite clear that it's going to affect all areas of construction. It's going to affect the new build, and it's going to affect the retrofit, because it's about how buildings are constructed, the fabric of them, but then how they're heated inside. I think it is going to be a tricky one to see what the skills demand is going to be. I mean, we forecast 5 years forward, and we generally find there's going to be a skills gap there in terms of numbers, but also the changes within the skills as well. The bit that's tricky is knowing what the trajectory for net zero is going to be. And I think that's something hopefully we'll touch on later, because the skills respond to the demand. And I think you can see certain areas where there's going to be demand. But the tricky one is obviously the retrofit for existing homes and how that's going to be played out. So I think, I don't know if Ian Hughes wants to comment on any of that.
Ian, sorry.
Yes, thank you. Our own research is showing around 22,500 roles will need to be created within construction by 2028. Some of these are quite significant in terms of specific occupations, such as project managers, trade supervisors, and building envelope specialists in particular. We do, having spoken to industry on an ongoing basis, we do feel the majority of the shortages will be filled and created through upskilling and retraining of existing workforce. So I think the gap in terms of the net zero agenda is a gap that has to be looked at in parallel with the overall skills gaps within construction itself, because you're not looking at 22,500 brand new occupations or 22,500 jobs. We are looking for industry to upskill and retrain their existing workforce in a number of areas to deliver large-scale interventions such as retrofitting owner-occupied and public housing in Scotland.
Thank you. And can I ask Gordon Nelson the same question about what skills gaps or new skills industry itself is expecting to have to develop?
Certainly. So far as we're concerned, our members are predominantly SME building contractors across Scotland whose end client is a homeowner. What we're experiencing now is acute skills pressures at the moment within industry, labour shortages across the construction craft trades such as carpenters and joiners, bricklayers, plasterers and roofers. But I do agree with the points made by the CRITB that it is predominantly when you focus on retrofit to decarbonise our housing stock, it is about upskilling the existing workforce. And speaking predominantly about what our members do, which is focus on being a domestic main contractor, and their focus is on the fabric and insulation measures, so reducing the heat demand of homes. So in their particular case, it's a question of upskilling and retraining their skills, their operatives, their supervisors to meet, hopefully, what will be established as a demand for amongst homeowners in particular to improve the energy efficiency of their homes and reduce their heat demand, and that consequentially will have a positive impact on reducing Scotland's carbon emissions. So that's my summary as where things stand at the moment.
Can I maybe just ask you, are you convinced that the companies that are your members are doing enough just now to help retrain and upskill existing workforce, if that's the main focus?
It's a difficult one. I think in one way it could be described as a bit of a chicken and egg situation, because speaking to members around Scotland, from Shetland all the way down to Dumfries and Galloway, they're aware of net zero 2045 and understand that a major component of that is on improving the energy efficiency of our existing homes and buildings. And they have a lot of the skills in place already. They are used to engaging with homeowners in particular and other clients, advising them and winning over their confidence. At the same time, a lot of their works now is on the home improvements marketplace, refurbishments, renovations, new kitchens, bathrooms and so forth. But what they found so far predominantly is a lack of demand for the energy efficiency fabric upgrades, and also on the technology systems too, because all of our members will subcontract to plumbers, electricians and other specialists to install energy systems such as heat pumps, for example. So there's a lack of demand, and a lot of members know that being business owners, they want to direct their business where there's a future marketplace. But without evidence of a marketplace, they don't have the confidence at this particular stage to invest in the necessary upskilling and retraining. They want to, but at the same time, being commercial and also dealing with the cost pressures now with building material increases the last 6 months, they're minded to keep the focus on what they describe as business as usual, rather than invest in a particular marketplace, which for many, they don't see it as it existing just yet.
Thank you. And can I come now to Martin Rain, if you'd like to comment on either skills gaps that are likely to increase, current skills gaps or new skills gaps you're anticipating, and what your members are doing to try and address that.
Good morning. Thank you very much for the invite to give evidence today. Yes, I suppose the current situation in the supply chain is our members often report that they don't have enough qualified people to carry out the work. So that puts a real strain on their businesses. And naturally, our workforce is decreasing and we're probably not bringing enough new talent into our sector. And that puts a real pressure on a business. Workloads at the moment are very high, and that could be due to COVID. There's a real demand out there, and that's right across the market, from new builds to retrofit to conversions and building upgrades of people's homes and such like. So for a business to invest in reskilling or upskilling someone, it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of resource. So it does put a financial strain on them. And with current traditional plumbing and heating works being, in demand at the moment, that's where these companies see their work. So it's very hard to convince them to start making a transition into, net zero skills when they've already got a lot of work that they're struggling to address and to complete, really. So, we need to support these businesses in taking on, more apprentices into the industry. And we really support apprenticeships because they, I think Skills Development Scotland say 92% of apprentices often go on to stay in employment, whether that's in the same sector that they've trained in, but that's a very positive, positive outlook. So, we're a big supporter of apprenticeships. So we would like to see more apprentices coming into the system, to support those businesses. But again, it's that financial risk or financial challenge that business face, because it does take a lot of resource to upskill somebody and bring somebody into the industry.
Thank you very much. And I'll come now to Grant Tierney, who I understand may be on audio only. Grant, can you maybe comment on what you've heard, where you think the new skills gaps are likely to emerge, or the current skills gaps? And obviously, we've heard already that there needs to be a demand from local authorities, and obviously from local authority building standards. You might have a sense of is there enough demand currently coming from local authorities to help stimulate training, not only in local authority areas, but also in the private sector?
Yes, good morning, everyone, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to provide evidence today. So I think undoubtedly net zero is going to bring a change to our guidance, and ultimately that will require some skills gaps to be filled. What we've been looking at quite a lot recently is what's called our workforce strategy, and a couple of key elements of our workforce strategy include things like a competency assessment system. So this is a single comprehensive set of competencies for all staff working in the building standards profession. It was launched in June 2021, and we're approaching the end of the first 12 months pilot. What this actually does is it demonstrates the competency amongst the existing professionals within the workplace, but more importantly, it highlights skills gaps and identifies where training is actually required, and that allows us to target it. So moving on from that, what we've also done as part of this workforce strategy is to develop a learning hub, basically. So it's a two-part piece of work. This is a virtual learning environment where we can provide bespoke building standards self-learning modules to all building standards professionals to actually then plug that skills gap. And with demand, as with most of the construction industry, we have an ageing demographic within the workforce. So we are also, as part of the workforce strategy, developing vocational pathways. And these take a number of directions. The principal one probably to mention is our modern apprenticeship scheme. In partnership with local colleges and the Building Standards Division, the Scottish Government, labs have been working to create a modern apprenticeship, and we've successfully got 22 apprentices as cohorts that will enter the profession this year. So again, that's just bringing new bodies into the profession to hopefully plug these gaps moving forward.
Thank you.
There are other elements other elements to this in terms of promoting the profession, implementing professional frameworks, but I'm happy to expand on those later in the discussion.
Thank you very much, and I'm glad we've got you visually as well. And then very briefly, and this is just to Ian, then Gordon and Martin, with the CITB just saying there that there's 22,500 new skilled jobs required, significantly a number of them from existing workforce. What is the intensity and length of training or retraining that would be required to upskill people for this demand in your particular areas? First of all, if I can come to the two Ians, or decide which one. Is it Ian Hill I'll come to first?
Hi. I think the training bit will vary slightly. It depends where the learner starts and where they want to end up the pre-existing knowledge, and it will also vary a little bit by the different occupations as well. I mean, you can be talking 1 to 2 years, you can be talking 3 to 4 years. It does vary. I don't think there is a clear answer on that, and it might be corrected by the people that will come after me, if that's okay.
Is it, yeah, well, I can maybe ask Ian Hughes if he wants to comment. And is that full-time, or is that retraining of existing staff while they're doing other work as well?
Yeah, I think when you look at the where you're targeting the retraining, there's a number of areas. So one can embed, and we have started this process, one can embed net zero learning units within apprenticeships. So whilst an apprenticeship may take anything between 2 years and 4 years, embedding the learning during their whole learning journey and experience will give them the skills when they qualify to move into that space. The alternative route is when you look at an existing employee who may have skills within the workforce that need to be upskilled and upgraded to move them into a net zero environment. In many cases, that could take a few months. It could be as quick as that, basically. Mm-hmm. Again, it depends on exactly what is required. The more difficult the skill, the more technical the skill, it tends to take longer. So a lot of the retrofit work, whether it's external cladding or rendering, whether it's basically internal fit-outs, in many cases, tradespeople have good skill levels. They just need to move up a gear and move up a certain level to get the right competency. It doesn't have to be a qualification necessarily, the right competency to work within a net zero environment, mainly within that retrofit space we discussed earlier.
Okay, and if we can come to Gordon Nelson, and we're trying to get a handle on how long this retraining or new training for the new skills will take and the intensity of it.
Yes, I mean, certainly supporting Ian Hughes' point there about embedding sustainability within apprenticeship frameworks. That's something for the longer term. And obviously, a typical construction craft apprenticeship in Scotland runs for 4 years. And there are other modules in apprenticeships last a bit shorter than that. But on upskilling the existing workforce, yes, there are shorter measures in place. One thing which we're involved in, along with others, including Martin at SNPF and the CITB, was in developing an installer skills matrix for energy efficiency measures, so that way industry will be able to see what the upskilling pathways would be for their operatives and their supervisors. And that way, that this installer skills matrix outlines the minimum qualifications and recognition of prior learning, for example, the existing skills and trades for both the technician side, electricians, heating engineers, for example, and also for the building and insulation side too. And these particular pathways are broken down by particular measures. The idea behind the skills matrix is to give industry the confidence and the map to see where, if they choose to, where they can access the relevant training, who provides it, how long it is, and what measure it is. So that way they can have a competent workforce to deliver retrofit or other particular other net zero aspirations.
Okay, and can I ask Martin if he wants to briefly comment on what he thinks will be required?
Yeah, so currently we have a very competent workforce in the plumbing and heating industry who, you know, what I would call time served, you know, they've served apprenticeships. These people can be quickly upskilled onto, for example, a heat pump training course that could take a week to 2 weeks. These companies deal with, you know, they deliver heat services on a regular basis, more traditional heat types, such as gas and oil and such like. So they have those fundamental skills. So, you know, support, you know, it's a quicker win, I suppose, a simpler fix to work on that current workforce. And of course, the modern apprenticeships, that's a more of a long-term thing. And again, we can adjust those to include more net zero focused competencies within there. So there's two strategies there, a short-term and a long-term goal. But yeah, like I say, our workforce at the moment is very competent at what they do and would be a quick win in this situation.
Thank you very much. And I'll now move to Natalie Dawn, who's remote, to ask the next question. And just to remind members that not all questions have to be allocated to all members, but it's been very helpful at the beginning to hear from all of you. Natalie Dawn.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Following on from the discussion on skills gaps, and obviously we've heard this morning about the 22,500 roles that will need to be created. In a previous session, the committee heard that there could be a concern that some of these new skilled roles might have a limited shelf life. So in terms of retrofitting buildings, as we've already discussed, Are the witnesses aware of this concern, and can you give any information on what can be done to ensure that any new skilled roles that are created during this transition are sustained, and to ensure that there's demand for workers to acquire the necessary skills? And could I put that to, I'll go to Ian Hughes first and then Ian Hill after that, please.
Yeah, thank you for that. Construction, by its very nature, changes constantly, and individuals have to change their skills levels and upskill on a constant basis. It never stands still. Basically, we're seeing innovation, we're seeing changes within the sector on an ongoing basis. And employers take a lead on this. Agencies like ourselves, we assist and work with employers to upskill and retrain. But I think when you look at the upskilling required for net zero, those skills don't go away, but they will be added to constantly. And I think the transferability of skills is important here, because when you have an individual who's constantly learning, constantly retraining and upskilling, he or she basically has pathways and pipelines into other occupations and other areas within construction that they can lend their skills to. So I think nothing should be done in terms of upskilling in isolation. We are always looking at upskilling individuals to improve their career opportunities, improve their skills level, because ultimately that will improve the business performance of employers in Scotland. So it's an ever-changing environment. We would not just upskill someone just for net zero. They have multiple skills at their disposal. We are looking at specific add-ons to their existing skill sets that satisfy the needs of a net zero environment. Those add-ons can change and can be taken away, but they are normally added to continually. So I see it as a positive step forward for the individual in particular. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Ian. I was just coming to Ian Hill next, sorry, if you had anything.
Hi. So I just went for the microphone to come off mute there. Sorry. I think Zane said, and sort of alluded to earlier, net zero is going to be part of the built environment going forward. It's going to affect every piece of work. In terms of particularly the retrofit being sustainable, you're looking at a programme of work that's going to span at least 20 years. And even if you're looking at installing things like heat pumps into buildings, those are still going to have to be maintained afterwards. It's not a case of put them in and leave it. So I think the skills there are going to be sustainable, because what's built now, is going to be around for at least, 20, 30, 40 years, if not longer. And they will need service and maintenance and ongoing work.
All right, thanks, Ian. No, that's really positive to hear that obviously that won't just be those skills on their own, and obviously there'll be transferable skills for when they might be needed in other areas, I'm assuming. In terms of apprenticeships that we've already discussed this morning, are any of the panel aware, in fact, I'll come to Martin on this, sorry, because I think it was yourself discussing the apprenticeships, whether the current apprenticeships or training are being adapted to ensure that those that are coming through for these new skilled roles, there will be a place for them within other areas in the future, sort of following on from what the Ian's commented there. If I could come to Martin, thank you.
Yeah, so the modern apprenticeships, they do get reviewed on a regular basis, and it tends to be a demand. We go to industry and ask industry what they want and what they need. So if they're not seeing a real demand for renewables, they might not come back and ask for these things to be embedded into a modern apprenticeship, for example. So we have to guide them a little bit on that and say, well, we know the future. We can see the future from policy and what government are saying and the targets that are addressed. So we do change them, and they do evolve over time to embed those net zero skills within. And, we're very, we're a big supporter of apprenticeships because they give mobility to people. The learner, the person that goes through that, has mobility and, have a wider career prospects and a better future. So we don't like things that are too sort of focused on just one skill. And like Ian, one of the Ian's mentioned earlier, it's about adding to the current skill set moving forward. So naturally, when demand comes, and when I say demand, you've got to look at the marketplace, the people that are asking for this work, that can naturally drive businesses to start asking for other things as well. And it's probably more of an organic evolution of the industry, if you see what I'm saying, Whether that organic sort of movement and transitional suit, you know, will match the demand, the targets of government, I'm not too sure. So work does go on there, and it does evolve naturally.
Thank you. No, that's very positive to hear. I think the main concern is that workers or new skilled roles might be too focused, and that could lead to issues later down the line. But no, that's very positive. Thank you. I'm quite happy to leave it there, unless any of the other panel want to come in. Thank you. Back to convener.
Thank you. And obviously, we're wanting in this inquiry to focus quite a lot on your work and relationships with local government. And local government obviously is procuring demand as well. So that would be helpful in any of the answers that you might want to provide later on. So I can come to Liam Kerr now, please.
Very grateful, convener. Thank you. And good morning to the panel. I'll direct my first question specifically to Gordon Nelson and Martin Rain, please. We heard earlier on about the need to create around 22,000 jobs. And Gordon, you said earlier about the need to upskill the current workforce. Now, SDS told this committee in evidence that the current labour market, they described it as hot, by which I think they meant there's a high demand for labour, there's a shortage of labour due to things like the pandemic. Now, are you finding, Gordon first, then Martin, are you finding that there are already skills or labour shortages? And if so, how is this impacting your members and their operations and indeed the planning for the upskilling that you talked about?
It's having a very big impact, I would say, certainly. And in the last few state of trade surveys, which is a qualitative survey of our members on their business confidence, we did find that skill shortages are right up there, particularly on the craft skills. I mentioned carpenters and joiners, bricklayers, and also what we're seeing, particularly since the end of the construction trade restrictions in April last year. So the first 4 months of last year, non-essential construction work were not permitted inside people's homes in Scotland due to COVID protection measures. And then we had a huge release of pent-up demand for domestic home improvement works. So huge booming demand, and also on the house building side, booming business in that regard. So we're seeing a huge competition for workers across Scotland with wage increases being a key sign of that. So I think there is a huge challenge, particularly for smaller and micro-sized firms, who will be absolutely critical to delivering retrofit measures in local areas of Scotland on a small scale, but across a huge cumulative basis. So in their particular case, how are they going to look ahead when they're applying their business, they're dealing with significant wage increases plus material price increases because of a shortage of key building materials. And it is a massive challenge for us to, at the FMB, to explain to our members the big potential they could have in delivering retrofit across Scotland and where the upskilling may be. And that's not pretending that it's not going to be particularly difficult to do that. So I think what we need to do is to somehow look at developing a national retrofit strategy that gives industry, particularly SMEs, the confidence that there's a stable pipeline of work out there, properly funded, properly supported, and coordinated by local authorities. And then they'd have more confidence to invest in the relevant upskilling through the installer skills matrix, through relevant pathways with local colleges and other training providers. And then we'd see that sort of particular pinch on skills and the lack of confidence of industry to upskill hopefully be addressed. But it does need a coordinated strategy and to give industry, particularly SMEs, the confidence, because they'll be a critical part of the delivering the retrofit solution, if you forgive my phrase. Thank you.
Very grateful. Martin Rain, would you like to add to that?
Yeah, thank you. Gordon gave such a comprehensive response to that. We're very similar and we have the same challenges in our sector. The number one complaint possibly from our members, that could be, you know, a sole trader, well, you know, a micro business all the way up to a larger contractor, is we cannot find enough people, qualified people, to carry out the work for us. So it's a challenge at the moment. And, you know, we do hear stories of employees leaving one company, going to another one. because they've been attracted there because the money, you know, the wages are better. You know, they're trying to entice them in because they need to satisfy their contracts. And, you know, there are situations where some of the businesses may not take on a contract because we know they can't fulfil it. So they're at risk of, you know, not completing a contract and letting somebody down. So it's a real challenge at the moment with that. And again, it goes back to the apprenticeships and bringing people in long term, you know, for the future and really starting to build on that at the moment. So, yeah, it's a real difficulty for any business at the moment. And I mean, it's good for employees, you know, qualified plumbers in the industry at the moment. You know, they're all in work, which is really positive. But it's not good for the businesses because we need more people.
Very grateful. Thank you. So moving on, I'll direct the follow-up question to Grant Tierney and the two Ians at the CITB. Gordon, in the last answer, Gordon just talked about, he said, the need to develop a plan or a coordinated strategy. Now, the Scottish Government and Skills Development Scotland published a Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan in December 2020, which presumably aims to achieve what Gordon rightly was suggesting we need to. So it begs the question, Grant and Ians, what engagement have you had or your organisations had with that action plan? For example, are any of you on the implementation group? And in your view, is it on track to ensure that the necessary skills are in place to support our transition to a net zero economy? And if not, who needs to act and what needs to happen? Grant Tierney, first of all, please.
So I think we've been looking at these items now, probably getting on for since 2019, when our Futures Board's work streams were first discussed, and that came on the back of some high-profile sort of construction failures. With regards to skills development, that is something that we are looking at through our engagement with colleges for our modern apprenticeships, where we are looking at the requirements within industry, and we are then looking at the current course content and providing bespoke learning to enhance the existing learning that is there. In addition to that, we also provide lecturing specifically to the current university courses for graduate apprenticeships as well, and that's with Glasgow Caledonian University. Apologies, you were breaking up when you were asking the question as well, so I don't know if I picked up on everything you were asking there.
Thank you, Grant. That was an interesting answer. As a part of that, do you have any comment on the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan from December 2020? How has that impacted on your organisation? And is it on track, most importantly, as far as you're aware?
So that will be fed into local authority building standards through the changes in the energy section and the sustainability section of our technical guidance. That is currently out for consultation just now. The consultation period is closed, and we will hopefully be getting the new regulations from the Scottish Government soon that we will then be able to upskill on accordingly. So what you're speaking about with regards to the net zero will be covered in our energy section. That hasn't arrived at us yet, but it will have been taken into consideration when writing the new regulations.
Very grateful. Could I pose the same question, first of all, to Ian Hill then, please?
Hi, Liam. I think the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, that we would have factored in when we were doing our net zero research, which was produced 2019-2020. So we'd have taken that into account. I think the more interesting question that you posed, though, is, you know, is it on track and what needs to happen? The on track is going to be a bit difficult one with what happened with COVID. That really disrupted the market. In terms of what needs to happen in the future, though, I think that links into the point that Gordon was making. Industry still needs that clear pipeline of how the ambition within the plan is actually going to be delivered. And when you look at the scale of work in Scotland, you know, you've got 2.5 million homes, 1.5 million are about owner occupied. There's still a lack of clarity about how that is actually going to be delivered and translate from ambition into work on the ground. And as Gordon and Martin have said, without that clear pipeline of how it's going to be achieved, there's always going to be a bit of a delay in businesses making an investment into training.
Very grateful. It seems to me that that is the crucial point, but then it begs the question, if a clear plan is required to implement the Climate Emergency Action Plan, who is going to drive that? Who is the onus on to create that clear plan that it sounds like you're all desperate for?
I think on that one, Liam, I think we've all got a part to play. But ultimately, some of that has got to be coming from government in terms of the... government is set, I mean, you'll be aware of this. Government has actually got two main levers. We can incentivise or we can legislate for making changes. And it's how those levers are pulled that will stimulate the market. If you go back to what's happened with the Green Deal and the Green Homes Grant, and there have been two attempts to stimulate that owner-occupied market and get energy efficiency upgrades happening, and neither of them have really delivered. So I think Scottish Government has got another stab at it. And that is the difficult one. You know, how are you going to get owner-occupied homes to make energy efficiency upgrades? I think everyone will be looking for the answer for that. We'll all try and help as much as we can, I think.
It's very helpful. Ian Hughes, do you have anything to add to that?
Yes, if you don't mind, if I can just read out very briefly verbatim a recommendation made to the Scottish CITB Council, which is our governing body on this topic. In conjunction and partnership with Skills Development Scotland, CITB should move to develop a detailed and specific skills plan for retrofit. This plan should map how skills demand will be met in line with the broader retrofit plans, sequenced and funded accordingly. New standards and quals will need to be developed, existing ones updated and provision aligned with the skills needed to deliver retrofit on a national scale. I think in terms of taking a lead on this, Skills Development Scotland being the national government skills body and CITB working in conjunction with industry in particular, we feel there is a gap and there is a need to map a retrofit plan out between now and 2025 and to look at how that is sequenced over the following decades and how it's funded in particular. Because at the present time, as has been discussed this morning, with the SMEs and micros in particular in the supply chain needing the confidence before they will really invest and take ownership of the net zero agenda, I think we all need to be working to a plan that allows us to share it with our industry partners and our employers in order for them to fully understand the opportunities that are available. Some companies are ahead of the curve here. We have members, we have industry partners who are investing as we speak because they see what's coming. The majority are waiting to see if it fits them in terms of their own business kind of requirements.
I'm very grateful to the panel. Unless Gordon and or Martin have anything particularly to add, I'll hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was very helpful. I'll now move on to Monica Lennon for her questioning.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our panel today. Last week, the committee had a really good panel session looking at planning and the skills that planners will need, particularly in local government. The Royal Town Planning Institute published research in June of last year, and that found that local authority planning budgets have reduced by 42% since 2009. I wondered if you could say if this reduction in resource has had an impact on how your members engage with planning departments. Perhaps come to Gordon Nelson first and then Martin Rain.
Hello, Monica. Yes, certainly what we've found from our conversation with members in our service is that certainly for our larger members and the house builders amongst the membership is that the delays in achieving planning permission and the time it takes for permission to come through has been a consistent problem and still is. So that does, particularly for smaller developers, where they don't have the capital as much as larger developers do, it adds to the risk from their perspective as commercial enterprises. And I think one thing which is fed back to me is that summarising what our members' view would be on planning resources, that they'd certainly support planning free increases if it resulted in an improved and more resilient service. They're aware that local authorities, particularly planning departments, have been struggling for a number of years with not enough planning skills across the local authorities. And they sympathise with that. But at the same time, if there's going to be more resources and fee increases, they expect that to be delivered in terms of an improved service. So yes, it is certainly a current challenge, and I think it could be certainly something for the future as well. At the same time, some of our members who are aware of the NPF4 consultation, National Planning Framework 4, that hopefully, I mean, there's a lot of in there about net zero and low carbon aspirations. If that can be joined up with the resources element too, so it's aligned, then that may help release some bottlenecks. But certainly speaking on behalf of our members being small developers, it is a particular challenge. They are sympathetic with the resource constraints of local authorities. And to some extent, without wanting to drag and grant necessarily, it also applies to building standards profession too. So they're aware that obviously there needs to be a resilient workforce amongst the regulation side within local authorities, both planning and building standards. Thank you.
That's really helpful, Gordon. Thank you. Martin?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I suppose it doesn't impact us directly because our companies tend to provide services on a subcontract basis into builders, developers and such like, but it does affect them. What I would say with their plumbing and heating companies is they tend to do what they have to do, or they tend to do what they're asked to do. And I think I can revert back to what Ian was saying earlier about legislation playing a big part here in the new build sector. And what you'll find is, if they're made to do things, they'll naturally do that. And we have seen this in the plumbing and heating sector in the past where, legislation's come in, or different ways of doing things, different requirements. And the plumbing companies naturally evolve to do it how you're meant to do it. The real challenge, like we've talked about earlier, is that retrofit market. So, yeah, it's more of an indirect impact on us. So if there's holdups higher up the chain, it's definitely going to impact our businesses. And they would look to pivot to provide services elsewhere, where, you didn't have planning involved, you don't have, building standards involved, so much more domestic-based work. But, yeah, it can have an indirect impact on us.
Thank you, Martin. I wondered, Grant, if you'd like to attempt an answer at that and maybe bring in the building standards perspective, because obviously planning and building standards are very closely linked.
Yes, thank you, Monica. Well, whilst we are very closely linked, it is a different set of circumstances that we are dealing with. We have been monitoring nationally our workforce data since 2019, and we can now start to map some trends. I mentioned earlier, we do have an ageing demographic profile, and it's anticipated there's maybe about a shortfall of about 10%, with regards to the supply and the demand for workforce. But that's across a fairly static workforce of around nationally 600 people. So it's not quite the same issue that planning are tackling at this point in time. I think encouragingly, we've now got a lot more staff who have been with us for a longer period of time. So now there's more people in the industry who've got 10 years experience. And I think positively, the gaps that we're filling there, we're seeing a number of graduate apprentices and now modern apprentices coming into the industry. So I think that's looking quite positively. With regards to fees, there is actually just recently launched, the Scottish Government are reviewing the building standards fee income. They are going to look back to the last fee income in 2017 to see what impact the fee changes made at that point in time. They're also going to consider some of the new works that we're going to have to do as a result of the future board. So again, that is being taken into consideration with regards to any fees. Building standards, or the verification side of building standards, is intended to be self-funding, though, from fee income alone, and that also includes sort of a 30% charge for overheads. What's often the challenge is that when the fees come into the local authorities, that they are used in the correct places to enhance the service, basically. Thank you.
Thank you, Grant. You mentioned apprentices. We did touch on that last week, that in Scotland there isn't a route for planning apprentices at the moment. I think that happened in England. In terms of growing the pipeline of planners, do you see a potential role for an apprenticeship route?
Sorry, is that with regard to planning or is that with regard to building standards?
Yes, for planning, I think you said there is an apprenticeship route for building standards. I may have picked that up incorrectly.
There certainly is a modern apprenticeship route for building standards. So it's something that we've been working on now continuously for a number of months. You know, we're very proud that 22 apprentices will begin their training this year. So they will be employed by local authorities and they will be then studying at Fife and Inverness colleges. And they'll start those college courses in August. The recruitment of those modern apprentices will be happening soon. Labs have actually met with our colleagues at HOPS and explained our, let's call it, our workforce strategy and the journey that we have been on. So, you know, hopefully they can learn some of the lessons from the positive work that we've been doing in this regard. But modern apprentices is just one asset of, you know, filling the workforce. You know, it doesn't just stop there. So raising the profile of the profession, which is being done currently by our ambassadors, and that's at schools, colleges and universities, because it's not just one thing that will solve this problem. You need to approach it from, you know, several aspects, and that interaction with people at an early stage, raising awareness of the profession, showing them that there is a career, is how you grab their attention in the first instance.
Great, thank you for that, Grant. Just want to turn to our CITB colleagues now. CITB have published commentary looking at the number of new skilled jobs which will be required in order to achieve the transition to net zero. Does CITB have a sense of how ready the skill system and industry are to deliver these skilled roles? I'm not sure which of the Ians wants to go first.
I'll go first, thank you.
Ian Hughes.
Oh, sorry.
That's fine. You've popped up first. Go for it, Mr. Hughes.
Okay, lovely. Thank you. Can I respond to your planning question first, and then I'll go back to this one, because I graduated as a planner about 100 years ago now. And in terms of the concept of a planning apprenticeship, there is a graduate apprenticeship model in Scotland, you know, utilised increasingly so by careers such as civil engineering. So in my opinion, there's no reason why you couldn't develop a graduate's apprenticeship for planning graduates as opposed to the full-time role. Now, that would need employers like local authorities to be the employer, obviously, because the graduate's apprenticeship model is part-time at university and part-time within the workplace. But I think if the shortages are such, then it's something that should and could be looked at fairly quickly. In terms of your specific question, in terms of the skills, I think it's when you look at the challenge in terms of the scale of what's required. If you look at retrofit, whole house retrofit, just within the housing market in Scotland, Scotland has 2.5 million occupied homes. 1.5 million are owner occupied. 600,000 housing associations or local authority, 400,000 private, and about 18,000 new build units go up every year in Scotland. If all of that basically has to be captured within a retrofit strategy or a net zero strategy, that has significant implications just in terms of the phasing of that, basically, and the timescales involved. I think a colleague said earlier on, that the process would, and we know it will take, it will move into decades, and will probably never stop, because you have to not just retrofit kind of once. You have to try and make sure it's not just a heating system you put in, but a whole house approach. Because a heating system going into a housing unit which leaks energy, has poor windows, poor insulation, it's pretty much a waste of time. So that whole house approach, in terms of the scale of the homes we have in Scotland, will have clear implications on the skills and numbers of individuals that we need to bring in to deliver that workload itself. So the 22,500 figure I mentioned earlier on isn't for the whole next 20, 30 years. It's to take us up to the next 10 years, basically, between 8 and 10 years. Looking further afield, and Ian Hill should come in now, he's the research expert. Looking further afield beyond 10 years becomes increasingly more difficult because the variables are more difficult when you don't have a clear pipeline of investment laid out. If you had an investment plan for 30 years in infrastructure within housing, you could start looking at the research over that period in terms of what skills were required. Difficult at the present time because we don't look that far afield. Ian, do you want to kind of pick that point up in terms of that kind of research capability and what's required longer term?
Yeah, I think I'd agree with what Ian's said. I mean, the main issue around the skills isn't so much the skills not existing, because they are. If you're looking at what's been put in retrofit measures, it's things that are here at this moment in time. If you look at what's the skills around for energy assessors, because you will need retrofit coordinators as well, that already exist. The main problem is that pipeline of demand coming through in the future, the number. It is a big number, whichever way you look at it, but it's how that translates through. In terms of what Ian was saying, we generally skills forecast about 5 years out. Any skills forecasting over the last few years has been really difficult. So even if you start to go beyond 5 years, it does get trickier. So we do a forecast, a rolling 5-year forecast for the sector. We do look a little bit longer than that. The net zero one was an example of that, but that's based on a set of assumptions made at a point in time, and it was based on meeting the Committee for Climate Change's targets and their pathway to see net zero deliver through to 2050. It'd be fair to say that those assumptions have probably shifted a little bit. We've probably lost at least 1 or 2 years with COVID. And actually, that means there's still a lot of work to be delivered. And the clock is ticking on it a little bit. So I think, going back to your question, Monica, I think the skills are there. It's delivering the amount of skills in response to the demand. That's the challenge.
Thank you, Ian. Just to pick up on what Ian Hughes said a moment ago about that lack of longer-term certainty about investment, so that alignment with investment plans is clearly important. So, you've any views on what should be done to provide more certainty about investment over maybe not as long as 30 years, but certainly longer than what we have now?
Was that a question to me, Monica, or Ian Hughes?
Well, yes, if you had anything to add, it's not compulsory to have a view.
I think for business will always look for certainty. And Gordon and Martin have commented on that as well. There'll be a certain element, certain number of businesses that will take a risk, will take a punt. Most of it, though, will be risk averse. They're looking at fairly short-term programmes of work. And having that clear pipeline takes away some of that uncertainty, takes away some of that risk, and gives the conditions for people to invest in training, because that's ultimately what it is. It's an investment in the future. I think, Ian, was there anything you wanted to add to that?
I think it's that, is that confidence within the SME and medium sector in particular, as to what's coming down the road. We have one of our council members in the CITB Council in Scotland, AC White, and their managing director, Jennifer Finn, works in this space in terms of external cladding within a net zero agenda. She procures only through local authorities and public sector procurement, and she's investing in her business and training and skills through the creation of skills academies within the business, and because she's already in the space and she tenders within procurement to deliver within a net zero agenda. So she has, and she still has some training support needs in which we will hopefully be able to assist. But that company is a good example of a company that has a niche space at the present time, is looking to grow its business within a net zero procurement route through local authorities in particular, and is investing via skills academies in its people to get the right training and the right skills level for them to deliver those contracts. But she's probably worth speaking to at a different time, because she has confidence in her business's ability to move into this space and grow her business I think other organisations, other businesses are waiting to see at the present time.
That's very helpful. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much. And we'll now move on to Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thank you for coming along today. Some of our previous evidence sessions, the committee's heard about the retaining staff in local authorities, and I know in some of Monica's first questions you were discussing the planning services and the building standards, but are you aware of any other services within the local authorities where you think that this is a concern that you've been made aware of, and if so, what impact has that had on you and your members? I think, can I go to Grant first and then maybe Martin?
Hi, thank you. I can only speak on behalf of building standards within local authorities. Fortunately, we're in a profession where there isn't necessarily a direct equivalent out in the private practice world. So we are quite good when it comes to retaining existing staff. We don't often lose staff. If they do move, they move to another building standards position within maybe a different local authority. So I don't really see that as an issue being for building standards, but I can't really comment on other local authority services other than building standards.
Okay, it's just that I know that building standards work closely with other departments. That's just why I was asking if you had maybe seen anything. If I can go to Martin, please, in regards to his services.
Yeah, so staff retention, I can't comment on local authorities because we're not really engaging with local authorities. Our employers are good employers. They have good conditions of work that's decided through the Scottish and Northern Ireland Joint Industry Board, which is a partnership with SNPF and Unite the Union. So we have good working conditions in the industry. But at the moment, like I said earlier, it's a perfect time for employees to move about. There's opportunities for them because companies are looking to complete on contracts. So they need that labour in there. So you do get some staff that will move around. Like I said, and I think it's been raised earlier, actually, is, the numbers in the industry are declining naturally through retirement. The workforce is getting older. So that's the real problem for us. That's the real challenge for us on our side of things. Like I said, the working conditions are good. So retention is pretty good within our companies.
OK, thank you very much. I was wondering if any of the Ians would have any insight into the shortages. And my apologies for calling you any of the Ians. I know that how rude that sounds.
Double E now. It's very common Scottish name. I think a pinch point for me, my previous job to CITB was in property and construction and development. And a pinch point speaking to local authority colleagues always seemed to be around procurement teams. They seem to struggle in terms of the numbers, the skills that are required in procurement. And I work with large local authorities mainly. And this isn't having a pop at individuals at all. It's really that when as people leave or procurement units were downsized and this experienced and skilled people left local authorities, how do you replace them and how do you get the right skills? And that takes time. If there isn't a pipeline of procurement experts from, the pipeline would tend to come from the private sector. If they don't move into public sector, you will see a gap there. And that gap, if there's a gap in procurement, there's potentially a knock-on effect because that procurement, in many cases in Scotland, is the pipeline for a huge, almost 50% of construction work in Scotland comes via public sector procurement. So if there's pinch points there, then that will have a knock-on effect. It will have a knock-on effect in planning and building control and even specification in terms of standards. I think it's an area, whilst I'm not an expert on, it's just casting my kind of personal experience that there's potentially an area there that there have been people leaving or downsizing of units, and it's taken a while to get that back up to speed again.
Thank you. And Ian Hill, do you have anything to add?
I would nothing to add over what Ian Hughes already had. Jackie, sorry about that.
No, not at all. I'll be honest, the procurement side of things was not one that I'd considered, so the answer was extremely helpful. My second question is in regards to last week's evidence session, where College of Scotland highlighted that the new Tay Cities Region deal, which was signed in December 2020, was a positive example of how partnership working, bringing together public and private sector to deliver the outcomes, especially on the climate goals. Can I ask if anyone has had any engagement with that city-region deal, or in fact any of the other city-region deals? Can I start off with maybe Ian Hill, please?
I think probably Ian might be a better one to start with on this one. I think I've not had any direct engagement with Tay City Region. We are having some engagements with Glasgow City Region. They're quite keen on using our labour forecasting tool to look at their skills needs going forward. And as part of that, even though Glasgow City Region aren't aware of it at this moment in time, we will be building in our net zero capability within that as well. So hopefully we'll be able to offer that one going forward. But we've just got an agreement signed on that one. I think, Ian, I'm not sure if you were fully aware of that as well, but we've actually just got that one sorted with Glasgow City Region.
Yeah. We're involved with all of the city deals and all of the major infrastructure contracts specifically. We have a product which is called a client-based approach, and that's extensively how do employers, when they're tendering or procuring work, how do they build in social values and social benefits in terms of skills and training? So that product has been adopted by all of the tier ones, which are the large organisations, the large employers in Scotland, and that filters through into city deals, for example, when we work on, we're involved in Tayside and Glasgow, and we basically assist within that product. We assist employers and clients to maximise the social benefits within procurement through that client-based approach, which is a product which measures impacts and KPIs and is embedded in the tendering process itself.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm not sure if any of the other panel members would like to give me a comment. If not, I'll hand back to yourself, convener.
Thank you. I think Gordon Tierney had wanted to come back in on one of the questions from... It's Gordon Nelson, sorry, you wanted to come back in on one of the questions.
Yes, thank you. On the current topic of local authorities' resources, it's a previous question. Yes, support the comment about procurement, that's something which is fed back by some of our members who work with local authorities delivering construction services, be that repairs, maintenance, improvement works to public sector estates. So the skills and resources of the procurement teams and local authorities, it is anecdotally, certainly, a concern amongst some of our members too. And I think also, just going back previously, when we were talking about the skills plan, I think looking more broadly, the skills plan, the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, is one major piece of a jigsaw, which would include the likes of clearer standards, accreditation, creating demand, materials, equipment, compliance. So it's a major piece of the jigsaw, but it's still a piece of the jigsaw in order to stimulate and integrate particularly retrofit measures around the country to give industry the confidence. So skills is critical, yes, but at the same time, it's much wider than that. And that's something which we're looking to work at as well. So that was why I wanted to come in earlier. Thank you for picking me up. Much appreciated.
Thanks very much, Gordon. And we now move on to Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I was listening to Ian Hughes's reply to my colleague Jackie Navarre's question there, and it kind of raises an issue around the Edinburgh Climate Change Institute highlighted a skills gap, perhaps in relation to the way in which green projects are being financed, and perhaps there's a lack of skills in developing business cases. I wonder, Mr Hughes, if you'd like to comment on that, I suppose, because most of the finance that would come through would be cascaded through local authorities. So would you suggest perhaps that's an area we need to look at?
Excuse me. I think our space, if you like, within local authority finance would be the procurement route, as I mentioned earlier, just in terms of how much influence we can have nationally in terms of utilising procurement as a vehicle to focus consistently on what we're trying to achieve within net zero in particular. I think within the the decision-making process of what those priorities should be nationally, I think it has to be a collective decision with local authorities, because they all have slightly nuanced approaches to community benefits and social benefits within procurement itself. If we had a conversation which said the focus over the next 20, 30 years within that space would be to ensure that the skills within a net zero environment where the social benefit we want to see from local authority funding, I think that would be a huge step forward, because the funding is there, it exists. What you're doing is focusing some of the added value with the employers who utilise that funding within the public sector. You're adding value, if you like, to the net zero agenda in terms of a bit more focus and creating a bit more confidence that you had the ability to upskill where required within that procurement channel itself. So it's a huge investment space that goes through local authorities in particular. I think there's a tremendous opportunity to consistently roll out the benefits of that within a net zero agenda.
I suppose, thank you very much. It's very helpful, Mr Hughes. I think as an addendum to that, really, is from what you're saying here, obviously there's new skills required and being developed and we're learning as we go on this sort of net zero agenda. So is there enough interaction between the private and public sector to ensure that the outcomes are as we would want them?
I probably can't comment on the interaction. What I would comment are the regional differences that we are part of. When you look at our employers in the islands, for example, Orkney, Shetland, or even the Western Isles, they have very different needs and requirements in terms of delivering the net zero agenda within their communities than we do have in the central belt of Scotland, for example. So I think the local authorities, in terms of their geographical location, will have slightly different approaches because the needs are different. But the end game, if you like, is the same in terms of that national target. And I think local authorities being able to kind of share that and collaborate in that experience would only be a positive step forward.
Thank you very much. Can I move on? I want to have a question to Martin Rain. I think the retrofitting of homes has been mentioned, and so maybe we'll use that as an example. We know that the Scottish Government has set a target between 2025 and 2030 of retrofitting 1 million homes with heat pumps, so 200,000 heat pumps per year. I suppose that sort of depicts how much demand will increase on the workforce as a result of that sort of activity. Are there enough resources in place, really, to make sure that we have an upskilled workforce that allows for those targets to be reached?
I suppose, you know, we're looking at doubling that output pretty much, you know, year on year to get up to those numbers. I think 2025, it was 64,000 renewable energy systems to be installed. We've got to ask the question, what are we asking our supply chain to do? So there is a demand for renewables at the moment. So are we asking these current businesses to start doubling their output every year? Which is, you know, that's a lot for any business to do, doubling size year on year. Or are we asking, you know, are we doubling the amount of people that can do this sort of work moving forward? So these are the questions that we're asking. Now, if you talk about a company doubling their output, you've got to think about the equipment, the components, the appliances that they're installing. They do cost a lot more money than what a traditional central heating boiler would cost. So you're then taking on more risk as a business. You require more credit. And, you know, when you're laying a lot of money out on the line, that's a massive financial risk to any business. So really, at the moment, you know, labour-wise and employment-wise, we haven't got enough people. So we definitely need to bring more people into the industry to start them on those modern apprenticeships, to get them upskilled. So they're ready for 5-6 years down the line. And we also need to look at our current workforce and, you know, go for those quick wins, you know, those quick solutions of reskilling and upskilling on short, you know, short courses that will allow them to go on and succeed.
Can I bring Grant Tierney in on that and probably add into that, you know, the in terms of the financing of Net Zero? Do you think it's all lying at the moment with the private sector, or where are the public sector sitting with the upskilling or potentially financing the upskilling of the workforce?
So I've touched on how we identify skills gaps and how we then provide knowledge to upskill that. And we are getting funding from Scottish Government to assist us with that. I think with regard to you know, the last piece of the question there about, you know, is the workforce there, are the skills there? When we look about heat pumps coming into buildings, we need to determine whether or not actually any warrant permission is there to see how, what impact that's going to have on local authority building standard services. But we have worked previously with partners in the private sector when we speak about our warmer homes initiatives, where we have sat down and we've given them a clear blueprint on what it is that they need to do when they're applying for warrants so that they can move quickly through the building warrant process if required. I would also mention that there is Scottish type approval scheme as well, which again is engagement between local authorities and private stakeholders, which streamlines the building warrant process. So hopefully that's how local authority and private sector engagement is working together. There's evidence of that to remove any of these concerns about the upskilling and the increased activity in this side of things.
Thank you. And finally, if I could, convener, just to finish off, can I ask Ian Hill, given that there's this need to increase the, you know, obviously the number of people working in the sector, do you think a bit of work needs to be done in raising the awareness and understanding and probably opportunity to the public and private sector workforce within the net zero environment? Perhaps we're not doing enough to highlight that.
I think on that one, Brian, I think, sorry, I was just having a think. I think that everyone's aware of the opportunity. I think there's enough work there that's highlighted the scale of the challenge. I think what you've got from the meeting today, I think, is the guidance about how that opportunity is actually going to translate to action on the ground. That's the gap. That's probably the bit that's missing. And if we could just go back to the question about the heat pumps, I wouldn't forget the fact that if you put heat pumps into building, you're still going to have to put repairs to the fabric. There's no point putting in heat pumps if the buildings are going to leak energy through the fabric. So while the Scottish Government might have the target for heat pumps, there's going to be other retrofit measures that will need to put in there. It's got to be a whole house approach. And you probably also want to make sure that if you're doing a retrofit, you're doing it once. It's not a case of doing some stuff in the next 5-10 years and then improving it again in another 10, 15 years. You want to be trying to get as close to that net zero target as you can at the moment. And I think there's a real opportunity for the local authorities and the local associations to lead the way on this.
And I think Martin Rainey wants to come in on this.
Yes, thank you. It's just, I suppose, really to identify something that's worked really well over the last year. And SDS introduced their AEG grant, which was £5,000 for employers to take on an apprentice during COVID. Pre-COVID, we would tend to take about 300 apprentices in the first year. With this AEG grant, it's actually allowed us to take on 391 apprentices for 2021-22. So it really shows a positive outcome for financial support to those employers. And there's also been some funding. It was a low carbon fund, which was a fund made available through the Energy Saving Trust, which allowed employers to upskill their staff, you know, on the heat pump training courses or solar thermal training courses. And that was very successful. So, you know, things like that do work. So these are, I suppose, these are solutions that we could possibly look at moving forward.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. Thanks very much to our panel for taking part this morning. The committee will have a private discussion on the evidence that's been taken today once our public meeting ends. And indeed, if there's any reflections, particularly on what you wish for local government, as obviously key partners of local government would be keen to hear from you as a supplementary to this session, if you so choose. So we now bring this part of the meeting meeting to a close, and I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting for the setup for our next agenda item, and our witnesses can now leave the session. Thank you very much. I suspend the meeting. Welcome back, and we now turn our attention to P&O Ferries. This session was scheduled following P&O's 17th of March announcement on staffing and on suspension of services. I refer members to the Clarks and Spices papers for this item issued on Friday. I welcome Peter Hibblethwaite, Chief Executive Officer, P&O Ferries. Thank you for accepting our invitation at short notice and for your reply to our letter received at 8:56 a.m. this morning. We've allocated around an hour for this session, and Mr. Hibblethwaite, I understand you'd like to make an opening statement.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So, first of all, can I say thank you for letting me make the opening statement to explain what has been a very difficult and unquestionably controversial decision, but a necessary one. But before I do that, I do want to reiterate, if I may, my apology to 800 seafarers and their families, and I guess specifically to this committee, the 39 seafarers and their families that were affected who live in Scotland. The backdrop here is that P&O has lost an unsustainable amount of money over the last few years and has not been viable for a number of years and not been competitive for that same length of time. And without a material change in the business, I would not be here answering questions about the loss of hundreds of jobs, as difficult as that is. I would be here talking about the loss of thousands of jobs, because without material change to this business, we would have had to close it. This business has been funded to the tune of hundreds of millions of pounds by our shareholder, who has never, not once, taken a dividend from this business. But it is not sustainable, it is not possible to expect a shareholder to unconditionally and indefinitely support a business that has no plans to change. So sadly, we had to bring about significant change. And at the core of that was this very difficult decision where we had to change our operating model. And it occurs to me that I don't think I have fully explained why this change to our operating model is so material. And so I'd just like to take a second to do that. The vast majority of the impact of this decision sits on the Dover-Calais route. And so it's better explained there, where we used to operate four full-time crews. Actually, in reality, it was more like 4.8 when you account for sickness and training. But we had to pay for four full-time crews who worked 24 weeks a year. This new model is a different way of doing business, and we are outsourcing our crewing arrangement. And through that, we will only be paying for two crews and only paying when they work. And it gives us clearly significant savings, but also an increased level of flexibility for us to compete. And this is a model that is radically different from where we were, but is recognized and used in 80% of shipping across the globe, and the cruise industry moved to decades ago. And so you then get to, having made this very difficult decision and where we needed to go from a model point of view, why we implement that decision the way we did. We assessed all options available to us, but ultimately we, the board, I concluded that they're all routes, with the exception of the way that we implemented this, led to the closure of the business. And as I say, the loss of thousands of jobs rather than very sadly hundreds. And therefore, because such a critical decision and because it was so radical, it was our conclusion that no union could possibly accept our proposal. And therefore, any consultation would have frankly been a sham. And so, of course, we are compensating people as we are required to, in full and upfront, for the failure to consult. And we are, on top of that, overlaying a significant package, a redundancy package, which is, we believe, the largest redundancy package ever issued in maritime history. But actually, and there's been a lot of talk about how big it is in the top end, but actually I think the thing that's most important here, whilst we didn't cap the top, what we did do is cap the bottom. And so for the people who are less well paid and be with us for a shorter period of time, who would normally have received a much smaller payment, we capped the minimum payment at £15,000. Where we sit today is that 765 out of 786 seafarers have started the process to accept that, and we will support the remaining 20-ish seafarers if they need any support making their decision about whether they're going to accept our offer. And now we move to, and just one last thing to say, now we move to two priorities. First, finding new jobs for those 800 seafarers. And we've engaged a number of different organisations to do that, but it's a clear objective of ours. And secondly, to restart our business. And in reference to this committee, particularly lung care and service, that I would like to bring back safely to a full schedule to deliver the trade requirements for the route between Scotland and Northern Ireland.
Thank you very much. We can now move on to questions. Can you explain what is currently happening with the European Causeway and what regulations are you not complying with?
Yeah, so we've said all the way through this that we would not let any ships go back into service unless they were fully safe. This is not a process we're prepared to rush. This is not a process that is limited by money or anything like that. And we have worked hand in glove with the regulators. In fact, I met the chief exec of the regulator yesterday. We had inspections of both the Causeway and the Highlander. The Highlander was passed to do a single voyage. The Causeway, we have some challenges on. Most of them, so there were 20 what are called defects. There were 12 of them were technical. Four of them were administrative paperwork type issues, and four of them were crew related. So absolutely correctly. And this is how it should work, right? The regulator and us should work together to work out whether a ship is ready to return to service or not. And we both concluded that ship is not ready to return to service yet.
You've acknowledged breaking the requirements of the Trade Union and Labour Relations Consolidation Act 1992 for business reasons. Are there any other laws that you would consider breaking if a similar situation arose? And can you understand why passengers would be very worried about travelling with a ferry company happy to break the law?
We failed to consult. I don't deny that. And we are compensating people in full for that failure to consult, as we are required to. This was a unique situation. We are talking about saving a company. We're talking about genuinely saving thousands of jobs that would otherwise have been irrecoverably lost. So we found ourselves in a unique situation. And in that unique situation, we took the path we took because, as I say, all routes led to irrecoverably losing those thousands of jobs. Of course, I understand that this is controversial. I read the headlines as much as anybody else. However, I believe that consumers and industry is better served by a P&O that exists than doesn't.
It's understood the UK government may bring in new laws as soon as this week. Would you commit to comply with any future UK legislation in this area?
Of course. And I can't really comment on what the Secretary of State for Transport might bring in, but there is talk, as you know, about national minimum wage. And I just want to be absolutely clear, the route that runs between Scotland and Northern Ireland as a domestic route, we are required to pay national minimum wage, and we do pay national minimum wage, and we will continue to pay national minimum wage. And if that were extended elsewhere, we will completely comply with it. And this has not been about rates of pay. This has been about a fundamentally different model. and having a level playing field for us to be able to compete and take a company that was not viable to a company that could compete.
Do you have any remorse?
I, on many occasions, I have reiterated how sorry I am for the impact that this has had on 800 seafarers, 39 who live in Scotland, their families, the 2,200 people who remain in the organisation that have had to answer a number of difficult questions. I'm very, very personally deeply sorry for that. I do, however, believe categorically that we would be talking about the irrecoverable loss of thousands of jobs had we not taken the very difficult decision that we took.
Do you have any regret? Do you have any shame?
I don't think this is about me personally. I think this is about saving an organisation, saving thousands of jobs. I regret that the impact that this has had, absolutely I regret the impact this has had on 800 seafarers and their families. But unfortunately, it was a very difficult but necessary decision.
And do you have any shame for yourself or your company?
I don't think I should feature in this. It's not, I'm not really worried about me. I'm worried about saving an organisation and thousands of jobs. And that isn't hyperbole. I really feel that. This is a critical decision that had to be made. Otherwise, this business would have closed.
A company director who breaks the law, I think, is a serious responsibility for any individual. I want to move on to finance before I move on to Liam Kerr in this area. The board of P&O Ferries Holdings considered this business to be a going concern with its annual accounts when it was signed on 10th of December 2021. So can you explain what changed in the last 3 months from a going concern to the summary sacking of 800 workers?
The going concern with the support of our shareholders. What has changed is that it is not appropriate for me or the P&O board to expect unconditional support for a business that is without their financial support viable, without a plan to change. I think we have received extraordinary levels of support, as has the British economy, over £2 billion worth of investment, but it is not appropriate for the P&O board to continue to expect unconditional support and have no plan to become a viable business in its own right.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Hebblethwaite. P&O accepts that UK employment law was not merely broken but fundamentally offended. Now, you're paying out £36 million under settlements. To make that acceptable to the employees, it presumably needed to include notice, holidays, a settlement sum, an aggravation uplift and a 90-day collective consultation award per employee. Now, one would have thought there must also be an upfront cost per month for the agency supply. So the question I have is, first of all, what is the cost of the agencies and how long do your projections show it will be before P&O breaks even on the settlement sums, the agency fees, the legal fees, the management time, such that this actually makes commercial sense?
Yes, okay. So you're absolutely right. This has been a very costly process. This isn't about the short-term financials. This is about giving P&O a long-term future or closing it. And we have been very generous in our settlements, as I think you're indicating, and frankly, as we should be, and as our shareholder would expect. The payback for this ranges from, depending on which scenario works out, ranges from 18 months, 2.5 years type thing. So this has an appropriate business case, which of course it should, but it is about long term. It's about long term keeping a business competitive, or making a business competitive and viable, and ultimately setting us up as part of a programme of change, of which this was the most difficult one, and future changes will be positive and growth orientated. But this is about long term, not about the P&L for the next few months.
Thank you. Just as a point of order, I'm not sure that I was suggesting you're being very generous just since you mentioned it. It is interesting that a two-year payback leads to the conclusion that you can't do the statutory required consultation, but I'll let others pick up on that. Now, one of the things that I think is interesting, from various parties' point of view, P&O registered losses of around 130 million in years 2019-2020. And I think the suggestion is that for 2021 there'll be a further £100 million loss, to which DP World has offered a facility of 100 million, which then begs the question, how certain are you that P&O is good for the £36 million settlement and the agency's fees? And have you given the agency's guarantees? Because one would have thought they may feel that they're taking something of a financial risk doing business with a company that you described earlier as unviable, and which chooses to ignore the law of the land if a bit of money is thrown around.
So this is a P&O board decision, supported by finance from our shareholder. I am absolutely confident about our ability to pay our bills. And of course, we have entered into a contract with the new crewing management company that both of us are confident is appropriate.
Just let me ask that a part of that question again. Did you give them guarantees?
So there is a level of guarantee, yes.
Final question for me at the moment, convener. P&O accept that UK employment law was broken, such that hundreds of employees could potentially have prosecuted unfair dismissal claims, and it is difficult to see how they could have been successfully defended. Now, I've no doubt in your planning you will have appreciated that the primary remedy for a successful unfair dismissal claim is reinstatement. So what planning did you do for a situation in which a tribunal orders the reinstatement of all of these employees? Did you plan to comply with such an order, or would that have been, that authority have been ignored as well? And had that situation come to pass, what loyalty would you have shown to the new agencies in that situation?
So our assessment was that we wouldn't get to that situation. And the reality is that the reinstating of our previous model, a forceful reinstatement of our previous model, would have put us straight back into the position where this is a business that would pose.
Yes, but it doesn't that... Haven't you just said that you would have ignored any such order from a tribunal?
No. So our assessment was that we would not find ourselves in that position. So we did fail to consult, and we are compensating people in full with that, and we're doing everything that we are required to do.
No further questions, convener.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Mr. Hebblethwaite. What bonus will you receive for driving through this new way of doing business, and when will you receive it?
There are no objectives, full objectives for me to deliver this. I mean, I can't tell you how far that is from any of our thinking. We are talking about saving a business and avoiding the irrecoverable loss of thousands of jobs. My personal bonus schemes have got nothing to do with this. We're talking about saving a business. We're not talking about me and how much money I get paid.
If you could just answer the question, are you expecting to receive a bonus in this financial year or in the next financial year?
No, I'm not expecting to receive a bonus. I have no idea what my bonus scheme looks like.
Thank you. Now, you've now had two ships detained by the Coast Guard on safety grounds. Will there be any more?
I hope not, but we are working very... We are under a level of through to me, and there are very, very thorough checks going on. We are working very, very, very closely. This is exactly how it should work. No ships will go out or should go out that are anything less than absolutely safe. I'm not going to rush this. We're going to work very closely with this. We're going to give our fleet team full support. We're having an open book arrangement with the regulators. We're in regular dialogue with the regulators. This is how it should work. This, you know, ships should be passed as fully safe, and never has there been more thorough approach to it by us or the regulators, and we fully welcome that.
You don't sound very confident, Mr. Heppelthwaite. Do you understand why many passengers are cancelling their trips and ultimately want to boycott P&O ferries?
I am absolutely confident, that no ships will be going out that are not safe. No ships are going to sea that are not safe. So if there was any ambiguity in my answer previously, then please let me be 100% clear about this. We have always said we don't have a business unless we have a safe business, and no ships are going out to sail unless they are safe, as assessed by us and the regulator.
I've been looking back at your comments to the Select Committee at the House of Commons last week. We know that you fired 800 experienced workers with an average service of 20 years. You sent in security guards with balaclavas and handcuffs. It is an extreme act of corporate terrorism. The Select Committee published their ruling yesterday, and they ruled that you are not a fit and proper person to run a company that operates critical national infrastructure. When will you resign?
So there's quite a lot in there. I want to be absolutely clear that there is a lot of press that is, frankly, inaccurate. So we did employ a security firm of professionals to keep our ships safe, but much, much more importantly, our people safe at a very emotional time for them. And the facts of the day, rather than the headlines of the day, the facts of the day, no balaclavas, none of those things that were reported on. And there wasn't a single incident, not one, of anybody being hurt, of anything inappropriate happening. So those are the facts of what happens. And you're, sorry, your question, you have
no, I'm just listening. I'm trying to believe you, but you have confessed to being a lawbreaker, so it is hard to believe anything that comes out of your mouth.
Mr. Heppelthwaite. To be fair, I have accepted responsibility for failing to consult. We are compensating people in full for that, and I have apologised to 800 seafarers and their family, and I continue to do that. But I must reiterate, we are talking about saving thousands and thousands of jobs that would otherwise have been irrecoverably lost. And your question about my resignation is, I have no plans to resign. I need to see this through. I need to get this business back up on its feet. I need to make it competitive, viable, and give us an opportunity to grow in the future and service the needs of Northern Ireland and Scotland on a route that I believe is incredibly exciting.
Mr. Heppelthwaite, you're leading the committee to believe that P&O ferries is somehow unique and special and above the law. And it sounds like you have convinced yourself that you are a saviour, that you are saving workers rather than throwing them overboard. The truth is, you are a failure of a chief executive, and most likely right now, in a crowded field, the most hated man in Britain. I just have a final question. Mr. Heppelthwaite, under your leadership, P&O Ferries has executed one of the most widely condemned decisions taken by a UK company. Your ethics are lying at the bottom of the seabed. How do you sleep at night?
It was, look, it was a very difficult decision. It was a decision that we implemented as effectively the only option that, in our opinion, we had. It was a decision that was, as I reiterate, designed to save thousands of jobs.
I've heard enough, convener. Back to you.
Thank you. Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. We've heard that you won't resign, but what will it take for you to resign? What needs to happen?
I don't know the answer to that. I think that I have had to make an incredibly difficult decision. I do think it was a better decision than closing the business. I think we had to implement that decision in a very difficult way. I don't think of myself as some kind of saviour, as your colleague suggested. That's not how I mean to come across. I apologise if it is how I've come across. But I do think we are talking about binary decisions here. Very difficult decision, but give the company a future. Or do not restructure the company and close it.
I'm not entirely sure that your sacked employees will agree with that one. Can I ask my colleague Emma Harper? She was down at Cairn Ryan last week, and she was speaking to some of the folk that have now been sacked, and they were raising some really serious concerns in regards to how a new crew can be health and safety trained to a competent standard so quickly. Can you maybe explain how long that will take, and are you confident that they will be trained to a competent standard?
Yes, I am confident that more than confident they will be trained to the appropriate standard, and that we will not let any ships go out to sail until they are deemed absolutely safe by both us and the regulator, and I'm not going to rush this. We all want Larne, Cairn, Ryan as a route back open and trading as soon as possible, but not as a compromise to safety, and I don't think anybody would like that.
And how long do you think that training will take?
I'm not actually going to be drawn an answer to that, not because I'm being evasive, but because I'm not going to apply a time pressure, something that cannot be compromised.
Okay, if I can go on to the pay and conditions, can you tell me what the difference is between the sacked crew and the new crew in the differences in pays and terms and conditions? What are the new crew not getting that the old crew did?
So, again, they're fundamentally different models. So, there's been a lot of focus on national minimum wage in the discussion that's being carried out in the public. And just to be absolutely clear, on Larne, Cairn, Ryan, we always had to pay national minimum wage, and we will continue to pay national minimum wage. So from that point of view, there is no change from the old model to the new model. The difference in the model is not about rates of pay. It's about, particularly on Dover-Calais, where we have to fund four full-time crews, whereas the new model means that we only have to pay for two crews when they work.
So you're saying to me today that every member of the crew will be getting paid exactly the same as what the old members were getting paid, and their terms and conditions have not changed? So they will still be receiving holiday pay, employer pension contributions and sick pay, for example?
So the terms and conditions will change slightly, no question about that. We're now moving to a model that is consistent across all of our routes. But my answer was about national minimum wage, which we will continue to do. The new operating model, so they're not directly comparable. This is not an apples to apples thing. But in question two, will we be paying national minimum wage? Yes. Will we also be making pension contributions, pay for their food, pay for their travel, pay for their accommodation? All of that is yes.
So their travel and their food, sir, does that included in their wages? And is that what's bringing down the terms and conditions?
We pay for it separately.
Okay, because I'm still to hear what the difference is to the terms and conditions, and maybe I'm just not hearing them. So if you can maybe, I just can't understand that if there's no change to pay and very little change to terms and conditions, why did you feel the need to sack 800 people to take on new people under new contracts?
So the vast majority of the impact of this is on Dover-Calais. And there are changes.
With all due respect, sir, I don't really think it matters where it's happening. It's happening.
No, okay. No, that's fair. Okay, that's fair. So fundamentally, instead of having to employ four crews, we now only need to employ two crews when they are working. So that's the major, major fundamental change. This isn't anything like as much about rates of pay as has been played out in public. This is about a fundamentally different operating model.
I still don't think I'm getting much of an answer, Convener. So, I think I'll just pass it back to you.
But passengers will be worried about crews that are not getting paid for half the year, and so therefore those crews will have to find other employment for the rest of the year, which means they will be very, I suspect, extremely weary and tired when they're operating on your ferries. Is that not in and of itself a safety risk? And should, as we expect, the UK government decide that the payment of the national minimum wage will put you on the same requirements as your competitors, for example, Irish Ferries, as you refer to in your letter. What is the benefit to MD apart from risk to passengers with crew that are very tired and weary because they have to supplement their income because you've halved the time that they are available for work and paid?
So I think it's quite important just to, I didn't say they would be tired and weary. This is an absolutely safe model. This is a model that is used in 80% of shipping around the entire globe. We recognise the intensity of each of our routes, and we will put in place appropriate rosters to reflect that. As I reiterate, this is not about us... This is about us moving to a competitive model. This is not about us undercutting other arrangements. This is about moving to a competitive model. And the safety, I assure you, it is safe. I assure you, no ships will be going out to sea that are not safe. And as I say, this is a model that is used in 80% of shipping around the globe.
Can I now bring in Natalie Dawn?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Heavilthwaite.
Good morning.
Given that your company was facing imminent collapse, can you outline how the remuneration for senior staff and executives has been reduced alongside that of seafarers?
Yeah, so the board level pay has reduced by about 50% in the last couple of years. And we are going to make further changes and reduce the size of the board very shortly.
Okay, thank you. In a response to one of my colleagues, you stated that this is not about you. However, I do understand that your salary is over £300,000 before bonuses, something else again picked up by my colleagues. Can you confirm if you took a pay cut to protect the future of the business, or did you ensure that your own interests were protected to the detriment of those 800 people who were unlawfully sacked?
So I was promoted into this job and given a pay that is consistent with, I guess, the market and this particular job. And I recognise that there are different levels of pay throughout an organisation, but I can assure you that we have reduced the cost of our senior management by as much or more than we have other parts of the business.
So can I just confirm in terms of yourself that that's a no then?
I have not received a pay cut.
Okay. And obviously we understand that some employees are being paid £5.15 an hour, which is above the International Transport Workers Federation pay rates. Would you be happy to work for £5.15 an hour?
So the £5.50, I would like to just qualify that, if I may, for a moment. So £5.50 was for the non-officer group, the group that we call ratings. If you include the officers, clearly the average rate is much, much higher. I don't think that seafaring is all about money. I think people love it. And that's one of the main reasons I regret so much, the very difficult decision that we had to make. Your question to me is, would I work for £5.50 an hour? I've chosen a particular career and a particular route through that, and it's led to me sitting here answering questions totally appropriately positioned questions about a very difficult decision that I've had to make. I didn't choose a path that led me out to be a seafarer.
Yeah, sorry. I was more, would you be happy to work for a £5.15 an hour? And I appreciate the comments that it's not all about money, but when you have a family to feed, yourself to feed, that's probably not music to everyone's ears.
But it is, as I say, and I think it is important that this is an international standard of shipping that is, that is crewed by international crew, and we pay above the standards by which we are expected to, including national minimum wage and including ITF rates.
Okay, thank you. Moving on, sorry, P&O Ferries, I mean, it seems to have been a largely profitable business up until around 2019. Would you not say recent losses are the result of COVID-19 rather than some fundamental challenges to the business?
I wouldn't. I think P&O hasn't been competitive for a while. I think it's been in decline for a long period of time. And I think P&O is a business that must become competitive and viable.
So can you elaborate on why the company was facing these imminent collapse, which caused this vast amount of redundancies, despite other operators being able to survive without such drastic action?
Sure. So we work in an increasingly competitive environment, as lots and lots and lots of companies do. Reality is that all of us need to move with the times to be able to compete. I think we as an organisation have struggled with this decision for a while. We've been aware it's an option. I think it no longer became an option to expect our shareholder to unconditionally and indefinitely carry on funding a business that that was not viable or competitive.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions. Thanks, Convener. I'll pass back to yourself.
We'll now move on to Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Heppelwaith. One comment I would suggest to you is that you see the new rate regime has not changed the rate of pay. However, I think what's important is how much is in your take-home pay at the end of the month, and I think that has significantly changed. I think those who it has affected would vehemently disagree with you. But I want to go back to a point that the convener made early on, and that was that when the annual accounts were signed on the 10th of December 2021, you must have had be a viable business because, of course, it's illegal to trade insolvent. And then 3 months later, you're asking us to accept that P&O was in such a financial crisis within that period of time, you had to let 800 staff go. Is that what you're asking us to accept, Mr. Heppelwaith?
So P&O has been supported to the tune of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of pounds by our shareholder, who have, and I do think this is an important point, never, not once, received a dividend for all of that support. It is not appropriate any longer for me to run a business that requires shareholder support with no plans to change and become viable. And therefore, we concluded that we needed to bring about fundamental change in the business so that we could stand on our own 2 feet without the indefinite financial support of our shareholder.
I say to you, though, as international businesses of the size of P&O Ferries, it is not unusual for finances to swing from positive to negative in the numbers that you suggest. And as I'm going back to this again, you could not trade insolvent. and in December 2021, payroll was a viable business. So why in that 3 months has it collapsed so much?
So with our shareholders' support, and we are now having to change the business so that we can be a viable and competitive business going forward. I can't comment on other shipping firms.
Okay, I'll tell you what, I've watched this story develop, Mr. Hebblethwaite, and I would suggest that you and the board are not stupid people. And in taking this decision, you must have thought through all the repercussions that may happen. You must have known that there would be significant pushback at the level it is. You must have known that this would not be allowed to happen. So I'm asking my question really to myself and to you, as I wonder what in all of this the outcomes at P&O are really driving at here, because you know you will not be allowed to deliver this the way you've delivered it.
So I don't think we do know that. I mean, we will see what the Secretary of State has to say, and of course we will comply with all of that. We are very clear we have not done anything illegal.
Yes, you told me you already admitted you did something illegal. You broke employment law. You've already admitted that.
That's actually not what I said. What I said is we failed to consult. And for that, we are compensating people in full. The headlines are not consistent with what I actually said. What I said was we failed to consult and we are compensating people for that. That is different from illegal. So we are very, very confident we have not done something. If the laws change going forward, we, of course, will comply with those. As I say, this is a fundamental change that moves us onto a level playing field with 80% of global shipping.
I think you'll find when you break the law, that is illegal. But however, I think that I'm sorry, but I cannot accept, Mr. Hebblethwaite, that you have not considered all eventualities here. And you must have known that what you were about to do was going to have significant pushback. And time will tell, Mr. Hebblethwaite, what outcome it is that you're driving for, but I do not believe that you thought that this would be acceptable.
I think it's important not to leave that unresponded to. We are genuinely trying to save a company. We are genuinely trying to make it competitive and give it a future. That's the outcome that we're driving for.
And now we'll bring in Graham Simpson.
Thank you very much, Convener. Morning, Mr. Hebblethwaite. You mentioned the shareholder quite a bit. Was the shareholder putting pressure on you to do this?
No.
So if the shareholder wasn't putting pressure on you to do it, why did he do it?
So the P&O board, me included, believe it is no longer appropriate and possible to expect our shareholder, who has supported us and the UK economy to quite extraordinary lengths, having never taken a dividend from P&O since owning it, is no longer appropriate or possible to expect the shareholder to unconditionally and indefinitely carry on funding a business that had no plans to make itself viable.
But if the shareholder wasn't putting pressure on you to do it, then wouldn't it have been sensible to ask the shareholder if they were happy with what you were planning and if they were content with the current arrangements?
So so we, of course, kept the shareholder, we had to go to the shareholder for funding. So, of course, we went to the European board and we explained our proposal and we gained funding for that. But ultimately, this was a P&O board decision.
Right. So it didn't come from the shareholder. Now, you said earlier, this was a unique situation. There's nothing unique about companies getting into trouble, and as you describe it, and having to make changes and potentially making redundancies. There's absolutely nothing unique in that. The difference here is that any other company would have gone through proper process. So why didn't you?
So we have always consulted in the past, and we will consult in the future. This was a unique situation. It was our assessment that all routes, and believe me, we considered all routes, but how we might implement this very, very difficult decision. Our assessment was that no union could accept our proposal because of the dramatic nature of making a step from our old crew model to a new crew model, and therefore consultation would have been a sham, and we are therefore, in the event that you fail to consult, we are therefore required and have and will fully compensate people for that to the tune of 13 weeks.
Sorry, what was unique about the situation? You've not explained that.
Because it was bring about fundamental change or close the business. So in 2020, when we very sadly had to make some redundancies there, we were not at that point looking about something as dramatic as closing the business. This time, this was different. This is a business that needs fundamental change to be able to compete and survive, and it needs major steps, of which this is one, and it is by far the most difficult. And as I say, we concluded that no other route was available to us other than closure.
Well, there's absolutely nothing unique about that. Many other companies have faced the same position, and they take a frankly more honourable route than you have chosen. Can I ask you about Grant Shapps, because he's written to you, and the convener mentioned earlier that Mr. Shapps may be bringing in some law changes. If he does that, how will that affect your business?
So I don't know. It's difficult, obviously, for me to comment on some changes that we have no sight of, but of course we'll comply with what we are required to.
Well, of course the changes could affect rates of pay. You said earlier that it was not about rates of pay, so presumably you wouldn't be too concerned about that. Would that be the case?
So we pay national minimum wage on routes that we are currently required to. So Lan Ken Ryan, which I imagine is of particular interest to this committee, we are required to pay national minimum wage, and we do pay national minimum wage.
OK, I've got one final point to make, convener. Now, Natalie Don asked you earlier about whether you would be prepared to accept £5.50 an hour. I don't think you would be, because I did a quick calculation based on your basic pay, not bonuses, and you are on a princely £156 an hour. So that's pretty good going. How do you think the sacked workers think of you when they look at that kind of rate of pay?
Yeah, as I say, you know, I've chosen a route through my career that has led to me to be sitting here in front of you today, answering totally reasonable questions. I didn't choose to become a seafarer. I reiterate my heartfelt apology for this really, really difficult decision and how it's impacted 800 seafarers, 39 of whom live in Scotland.
Thank you. Can I ask, will the new crew be unionised?
So the crew management company will have recognition with ITF.
And do you understand that
the actual individuals, obviously, is a decision for those individuals. Don't have visibility.
And do you understand that it's not for an employer to decide what a union thinks or will respond? It's for the union to decide that. Why did you not respect that fairly fundamental basic principle of employer trade union relations?
I don't believe, we did not believe, that any union could possibly have accepted our proposal given the fundamental nature of change that we were potentially going to have to propose.
If I can move on to further questions on your shareholder, which you've put great store by, that you wanted to oblige the shareholder, even though you're saying that they didn't instruct you to carry out the actions that you did. Your your shareholder has fundamental interests globally, but also has fundamental strategic interests, for example, in free ports that are currently being developed by the UK government and green ports as developed here in Scotland. Do you not think that you are jeopardising not only the reputation of your shareholder, you're jeopardising the strategic aims of your shareholder, and that that may prove counterproductive in their interests?
So obviously I'm not here representing our shareholder, so I can't speak for them. What I would reiterate is our shareholder is an organisation that have invested over £2 billion, has invested more in the UK economy than any other country that they operate in and out of, apart from the UAE, and have been very, very supportive. Clearly it's a regret of mine that they have been drawn into this, but they have been very supportive of this business.
I bring in Monica Lennon as a supplementary on this before I come to Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. On the back of your questions, it's clear that Mr. Heppelthwaite and Pino Ferries don't respect trade unions. I think you've just picked a big fight with over 500,000 trade union members in Scotland alone, never mind the rest of the UK. You had a chat with the First Minister last week. She may have talked to you about the importance of fair work and the Fair Work Convention in Scotland. Right now, there are calls for, you know, a boycott of Pino Ferries and for your company to be effectively blacklisted so you don't benefit from any public project or public money in the future. If you and DP World are not allowed to be part of a freeport in the future, is that a price worth paying for your new way of doing business?
So just, I think it's important I do come back on where you started this. I absolutely respect unions and we will continue to work with the unions that we work with. This was a radical change we had to bring about in it, and we just did not believe that a union could possibly accept, that any union could possibly accept what we're proposing. I don't think it's right to say that doesn't mean we don't respect them.
One of the principles of fair work, one of the principles is effective voice. You chose to silence the workers and our unions. How is that showing respect?
So I have full respect for the unions. We will continue to work with all of the unions that we have representing our workers.
Okay, I'll bring in Liam Kerr next.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Heppelthwaite, I understand there are a number of land-based employees of P&O, many of whom will be based at Cairn Ryan. Does P&O have any strategic plans, whether finalised or in draft, which would impact them in some way? Because obviously, if they are to be restructured, tupied or dismissed, they would be legitimately concerned.
No, we don't. They're obviously all parts of our organisation. With the Cairn Ryan, so the short answer is no. The Cairn Ryan port is very, very important to us. We've invested over £40 million in the port. I think that Larn Cairn Ryan and the Irish Sea is a very exciting opportunity for us going forward. But the specific answer to your question is no, I don't have plans to make those changes.
I'll just push that point, if you don't mind, Mr. Heppelthwaite, just for absolute clarity. You are telling this committee there are no strategic plans, whether in draft or finalised, to do anything to the land-based staff at Cairn Ryan. Is that correct?
So what I think you are referring to is a paper outlining options for us to look at how we ran the Cairn Ryan port, none of which were taken forward. So that there is a document that exists to that effect, it's from a number of months ago, last year. None of those options have been taken forward.
That seems to be a slightly different answer to the first one you gave me. Mr. Heppelthwaite, I wonder if that's going to be published and publicly available. Just the land-based employees, one would have thought, would need to know the details.
So the land-based employees have seen that paper, as have the unions. It was a private document that a piece of work that we went through, as all businesses go through, in terms of looking at options available. We considered a number of options, as all businesses do, and we chose not to take any of them forward. I've had this conversation with the union, and I've had this conversation with the shore-based team in Cairn Ryan.
One final thing from me, convener, if I may. And it's something that my friend Monica Lennon brought up earlier, which really does trouble me. Mr. Helbersway, you accept that you willfully, consciously and knowingly broke the law. You offended against UK employment law, a law which Parliament felt so important that it attached a protective award to it to try and mandate compliance. Doesn't that trouble you as a company director and make you question whether you are truly a fit and proper person and discharging your fiduciary duties to your company if you are content simply to break one of the strongest laws that Parliament has sought to put in place?
To be clear, we failed to consult and we are compensating people in full, absolutely as we should and up front. My duties as a director are to make this business viable going forward, and I was faced with the option of a programme of change or the closure of the business. And I think as a company director, I took the only route available to me to preserve thousands and thousands of jobs.
Well, that is not your only duty, Mr. Helbersway, is it? Because you have fiduciary duties, you have legal duties as a company director. And what I actually asked was whether you considered that you are a fit and proper person who is discharging those duties, not merely the one that you've talked about there, but the full raft of fiduciary duties to your company when you willfully and knowingly took a decision to offend against one of the strongest laws that Parliament has sought to put in place.
So I did consider that, and I believe I have discharged those duties.
No further questions, Convener.
Finally, Jackie DeBar.
Thank you, Convener. Going back to the Cairn Ryan seafarers, if you don't mind, Cairn Ryan is a domestic route and PA and DO do need to comply with the UK employment law at Cairn Ryan and for the staff on that route. So why are the Cairn Ryan seafarers included in the sacking, especially when the new staff are being paid the same as the sacked ones that you said to me earlier?
So this is about implementing a crewing model that is consistent throughout our organisation, a crewing model that is consistent with 80% of global shipping. Your question is why? Because we're implementing a crewing model, a fundamental change across the whole of our business. It's not an apples with apples thing. We're moving from one crew model that was uncompetitive and made us unviable to a totally different thing that is consistent with 80% of global shipping.
But with all due respect, you said to me earlier that the new staff are being paid the same as the sacked ones. Why is the Cairn Ryan seafarers included in that?
So that's not what I said. What I said was that we were required to pay national minimum wage on the Lion Cairn Ryan route. And we were. And in the new model, we are required to pay national minimum wage, and we will, of course.
But you did say to me earlier that the pay was the same and the terms and conditions were slightly changed, but not a lot. So that was why I'm asking, why did you need to sack the Cairn Ryan seafarers?
So, to be clear, with reference to the rates of pay not changing, I was referencing national minimum wage that we always previously paid, and we will absolutely be paying going forward. And this is not about Lion Cairn Ryan, this is about us having a crew model across the entire organisation that is consistent and competitive.
I'm sure they'll be comforted to know it's not about them. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you, and can I thank you for attending this session, Mr. Hebblethwaite. In my 20-plus years as a member of the Scottish Parliament, I'm not sure I have come across an issue with an employer that has united unilaterally right across the Chamber such hostility. And the people that we represent, our constituents, even those that are not in the south of Scotland or in Cairn Ryan, are absolutely disgusted and dismayed that a company of your reputation and your shareholders' reputation has treated people with such disrespect and lack of dignity at work. But I do thank you for taking the time to attend this session, and we'll discuss the evidence that we've received later in this meeting. So I now close the public part of the meeting. I wish everyone a restful Easter break. Unfortunately, that will not be the case for the many P&O workers that have suffered at the hands of this chief executive. Thank you. I now close the meeting.